Good morning, everyone. My name is Dr. Rashid Ali, and my moderator is Dr. Adnan Sarwar. And today we will discuss about the role of open surgery and the management of renal stone disease. So our learning objects will be inotropic nephrolithotomy, open pyrolithotomy, and open urethrolithotomy, and open systolithotomy. These are procedures which we are performed on daily basis. Urolithiasis in open surgery. Urolithiasis is a global pathology with increasing prevalence rate. The lifetime recurrence of urolithiasis range from 10 to 75%, creating public crisis in affected region. The surgical management of stone is based on the stone location, size, and patient preference, and the institution capacity. In the development of shockwave lithotripsy, URS, including flexible and semi-rigid, PCNL, laparoscopic, and robotic stone removal has resulted in the few current indication for open surgical stone removal. There are a small number of patients who are extremely large stones with complex clearances anatomy who may be still candidate for open surgery. It is recognized that these procedures are undertaken in the portion of the world where the aforementioned techniques or expertise is not available. Significant change in current management of urolithiasis where the indication for open stone surgery narrowed significantly, marking it as a second or third line treatment option. Preoperative management of urolithiasis patient and orientation of the stone in the kidney is best defined by CT, scan, and three-dimension reconstruction. As a patient does not adequately define collecting system, anatomy, intravenous, or retrograde phylogram is performed. MAC3 or DMSA also perform if the on CT findings kidney look, is not good. Or we think it is poorly functioning kidney. Antibiotic should be prescribed before surgery, and then mainly the sting or stone, these are infected stone, they should be treated. And crossmen should be taken if there may be need of blood transfusion. The utilization of scleral lower extremity compression device to prevent thromboembolic complication is advocated. General anesthesia administered and police catheterization is inserted before making position. Positioning of the patient. The patient is placed in the lateral decubitus position. Cushions are placed along the spine, just below the axilla and between the legs. The patient is secured to the table with the pads and white tape circling the mid chest and hip. This is the position of the patient for renal surgery. The patient is in decubitus position, and same side which we are doing surgery, the legs would be extended, and the opposite side legs would be flexed 90 degree, and the pad should be applied on the pressure point areas, and the pillow should be put between the two legs, and actually this pad should be applied to secure the patient, and the legs we straight, we actually want to create some tension, and the legs we flex, the patient should be stabilized on table. The incision should be 11th or 12th supracostal. Incision is generally used. The plank facial layers are open, and diaphragm and pleura are mobilized superiorly, and the peritoneum medially swept. The utilization of self-retaining retractor is recommended. These are some incisions which are show like 12th supracostal incision, which is started from the posterior axial line. That extend that may be extended into the lateral border of rectus abdominis muscle, and the 12th rep transcostal and thoracoabdominal incision also be used, and pollicis muscle splitting incision which is started from the renal angle and to the anterior superior iliac spine. This is basically muscle splitting incision, and we give to when patient with muscle splitting, there is a less chance of postoperative pain. And the plank subcostal incision, which mainly aim for pyeloplasty. And these are the incision which showing. This is started from the posterior axial line, which extends to the lateral border of rectus abdominal muscle. These muscle fibers which we cut the external oblique muscles, and the internal oblique muscle, transverse abdominal, lumbar dorsal, and then we reach into the lumbar dorsal, and then we have to make a window between the 12 or 11 reps and the window. We push the peritoneum medially and the pleura and diaphragm upward, and make sure the pleura is and the anterior is attached to the atrius, and the maxillary line it is on 10, and posterior it is attached to the 12 ribs. And sometimes we have to extend this incision. We have to cut posteriorly latissimus dorsi muscle fibers and the serratus posterior muscle fiber. They should be cut if we have want to extend the incision. Renal dissection. Gerontopsia is longitudinally open over the posterior aspect of the kidney. Prenapric PET is carefully dissected up. The kidney is taken care to not enter in a subcapsular plane. The ureter, renal artery, and renal vein are dissected out and encircled with a Whistle loop. This is a slide which showing the prenatal PET is dissected, exposed in the capsule, and receptor is attached. Now, the main goal is identifying the anatropic plan for anatropic nephrolithotomy. The posterior segment artery is temporarily occulted with a Bell-Dog clamp, and the patient is administered with one ampule or 20 ml of methylene blue intravenously. This is typically result in the branching the posterior segment of the kidney, which contrasts the blue color parenchyma as remainder of kidney. The defined plan is then marked on the renal surface with topical application of the methylene blue. The Bell-Dog clamp is removed. If an anatropic plan is not defined, intraoperative Doppler ultrasound may be helped define the best plan for nephrectomy. This is the best slide which showing the way in which we claim the posterior segmental artery and methylene blue is given. Then the blood supply of the anterior segment they turn into blue color, and then we mark the borderline. The borderline which is on the concave surface of the kidney, which is approximately 1 to 2 cm posteriorly, and then we mark their incision line for anatropic, and then we will give incision nephrectomy and stone removal. The superficial incision is made along the previously defined anatropic plane, which we already defined by methylene blue or with Doppler ultrasound. The parenchyma is bluntly stemmed and entered. This is further open to expose the stone. The stone is manipulated out using the stone forceps. Can anyone tell me why a stone forceps? Why we cannot use our hand to remove the stone? Because these are mainly infected stone, we can spread the infection to other part of the body during manipulation, and this way we use mainly forceps. This is the way we open the broader line, and then we will remove the stone. The nephrectomy may need to be enlarged and the collecting system incised further to deliver the branched stone without fracture to the stone. A stone should not be fractured. Also, other stone removals are removed with the forceps. Separate incision should be made in each moiety. If there is double moiety, there should be separate incision for each moiety. Segmental branch and kidney with biped collecting system. Ice sludge is applied and is necessary to keep the kidney adequately cold. The renal vein can be occulted if the bleeding obscure visualized. If we cannot normally clamp the vein, if there is a bleeding occur, then we can also clamp the vein. Image is repeated once all stone is removed. If residual stone is demonstrated, the targeted portion of the kidney is explored. The stone are typically located behind the stenotic appendibulum, which can found with a gentle probing and sometimes gentle palpation of the parenchyma. Complete removal is confirmed with repeated imaging study. At the same time, we cannot confirm the complete clearance of the stone. That will be show after the when follow-up patient will come, we will do ultrasound, and then we can clear the patient. It is a stone clear or a stone not clear completely. After this, we put a DJ stand and a nephrostomy tube can be placed. Now, renal closure. All transected vessels are ligated, absorbable 0 to 6 liters. running observable 5260 monofilament can be used to close the collecting system. A collecting system and the parenchyma, they should be closed and separate layer, and two layer they should be closed. Return of the good turgidity occur prominently. Bleeding may be seen toward the nephrostomy and usually cease with an application of the gentle pressure for 5 to 10 minutes. Tissue land may be applied to suture line if low volume bleeding persists. The renal artery clamp removed to find the source of bleeding, which is typically aortum. Once hemostasis is achieved, gerontopecia is reapproximate around the kidney with observable 2-30 suture. A closed suction drain is placed posterior to kidney and brought toward a small separate incision. The facial layer and skin are closed with standard pressure. These are beautiful video is showing about the inotropic nephrolithotomy. This will show the incision is given. And the muscle fibers are cut. And they are resecting the ribs, basically. The ribs should be resected and there most space will be available. Ribs resected. And then mobilized, complete kidney has been mobilized. Broader line is identified. And the renal artery clamp is applied, and Boldo clamp is applied to the renal artery, then ice sledge is placed to cool the kidney. Now the incision is given on the broader line, which is identified, which can be identified by going methylene blue, or which can be identified on the Doppler ultrasound. The incision is given. Then renal parenchyma is open. Then the collecting system is open. And next one is visualized. These are stones which are being removed by a help of forceps. Then putting a DJ stent. And post-op care. The patient is closely monitored for sign of hemorrhage and the renal insufficiency. Because we have done and we cut the kidney in the inotropic plane, and there should be kidney should be monitored for any ischemic changes. The drain is typically removed when there is no indication of urine leakage. The patient is manipulated on the antibiotic therapy. The stent is usually removed 3 to 3 weeks after discharge. Complication of the inotropic nephrolithotomy, the preoperative complication may be including wound infection, sepsis, acute tubular necrosis, damage of the main or segmental artery and vein, injury to the collecting system, ureter and surrounding structure. Pneumothorax, atelectasis, pneumonia, venous thrombosis event, and renal hemorrhage may occur. Now we'll discuss the pyrethotomy. Preoperative evaluation, patient preparation, and incision. The preoperative evaluation and preparation are similar to those of the inotropic nephrolithotomy. This procedure should be avoided if the patient is in intrarenal pelvic. The kidney may be accessed toward a plank, subcostal, dorsal lumbotomy, or midline incision. Exposed of renal and pelvic. The gerontopecia is incised posteriorly and the perinephric pad is dissected off the posterior surface of kidney. The proximal ureter is isolated and dissected and carefully extended proximally, and posterior surface of the renal pelvic is delineated. Utilization of the galvanite retractor is used to expose the renal sinus. Care is taken not to injure the posterior segmental artery, which is typically caused just inside the posterior renal sinus. This should be should not be damaged. Esternal new shape curviline incision is made with a scalp or port scissor, with the lower extent at 1 centimeter above the uteropelvic junction. That should be 1 centimeter above the uteropelvic junction. Why it should be above the uteropelvic junction? Why not below? Because there is a more risk of secondary PUJ obstruction, and this way we our incision should be above the uteropelvic junction at least 1 centimeter. The stone are extracted with the stone forceps. Take care not to extend the pilotomy. All collection system can be examined with a flexible nephroscopy or intraoperatively imaging if available, can be utilized to confirm complete stone removal. The technique of extended pilotomy can be used to obtain further exposed and tessellated stone removal. And this modification of the pilotomy is carefully extended superior into the subjective infundibulum. Inferior exposed can be enhanced by declining the inotropic demarcation as previously described and making small nephrotomy along the inferior edge of the inotropic plane. This is the pilotomy incision. Pelvic should be dissected and the galvanized retractor should be applied. And the U-shaped incision is given. And the galvanized is applied and the pelvis is open and with the port scissor and the stone removal done. Closure of pilotomy and wound closure. An internal uretric stent can be inserted at the discretion of the surgeon. The surgeon prepares and then should be inserted. We open the any on the pelvic system. There is a more tissue injury, then stenting should be done. The pilotomy is closed with running or interrupted port 0-60 observable suture. A closed section drain is placed posterior to kidney and brought out in a separate small incision. Routine wound closure technique are employed. This is a wound which is closed interrupted suture. Postoperative care. The patient is similar to that described for the patient subjected to inotropic nephrectomy. Complications similar to those with anatropic nephrectomy, but the risk of acute tubular necrosis are negligible. As renal circulation is not interrupted, the posterior segmental artery can be injured during manipulation in the proximal portion of the renal pelvic and renal sinus. Urine leak may develop, and the patient is managed with the standard approach. Uteropelvic junction obstruction and proximal ureteric structure develop are also among possible complications. Now we'll discuss about the open urethrolithotomy. Urethrolithotomy in the mid-1980s, urethrolithotomy was the primary procedure performed for removal of the uretric stone. With the emergence of endoscopic technique, extracorporeal shockwave lithotripsy, robotic and laparoscopic urethrolithotomy, now rarely open urethrolithotomy is performed. Urethrolithotomy is still used in the situation in which endoscopic access to the ureter is not technically possible and the targeted stone is not amenable to ESW or pale ESWL. Developing countries without access to the URS. Radiographic identification of the stone at the time of surgery is crucial, as the location of the incision is determined by the location of the care. When patient is going for urethrolithotomy, we have ultrasound or X-ray should be done to localize the stone, because the incision depends on the location of the stone. Surgical approach. Upper third of the ureter. A plank incision with or without rib resection, lumbotomy incision, subcostal incision or supracostal incision may be used. A midline incision with intraperitoneum or extraperitoneum approach can be used if the patient is extensive prior retroperitoneum surgery. Mid third of the ureter. A pollice incision or midline extraperitoneum incision is used. Lower third of the ureter, a lower midline incision with extraperitoneum approach is mostly useful. Gapson incision can be used if it is advantage of lowering access to the mid ureter. The curviline incision 2 cm medial to the anterior superior spine and inferior medially 1 finger breadth above the inguinal ligament to the lateral border of the rectus abdominal muscle. This is a Gapson incision, which is showing the cut the external oblique, internal oblique, and transverse abdominal muscle and transverse fascia. Then we swept the peritoneum medially, and then we approach the ureter. Penicillin incision also can be used for distal ureteric stone. It is very important not to let the stone migrate from the operative field during the course of procedure. It is also paramount to consider the anatomy of the ureteric blood supply. When we are dealing with the ureter, we have to hide about the ureteric blood supply. The ureter vascular supply originates medially above the iliac vessel and laterally below the iliac vessel. Attempt should be used to muscle splatting incision whenever possible, decrease postoperative pain. Ureter is to begin approach the ureter using whatever incision is demand most appropriate based on the patient anatomy, stone location and prior surgical history. And in general, the dissection will take place in the extraperitoneal space. However, transperitoneal dissection can if it is necessary. Manipulate the ureter minimally during the dissection to lessen chance of stone migration or ureteric devascularization. When the stone is located by visualizing bulge or with gentle finger tip palpation of the stone, secure proximal control of the ureter with either a Babcock clamp or loop vessel should be proximal and distal portion should be clamped to prevent the stone migration. The distal ureter is then controlled with either Babcock clamp or vessel loops. 2-4-0 observer suture are taken place on either side of the ureterotomy. When we are taking ureterotomy, the suture should be taken. Do not open the ureter until the stone is confirmed to be present at the site. The ureter is open longitudinally over the stone with oak blade or incision can be extended using with port scissor. Once the stone is removed, the ureter is irrigated with normal saline proximally and distally using a red rubber catheter to ensure that there are no remaining fragment. A stent can be placed. Although this is a matter of the surgeon preference and is likely unnecessary for a simple ureterectomy. In this slide, we are showing the ureter is completely immobilized. This is in a proximal and distal control are taken with a bulldog clamp with the Babcock forceps. And this, we are getting stress suture are taken and the ureterectomy is done on the vertical plane. And this stone is being removed from the ureter. And this slide is showing this interpreter absorber suture. Ureter is closed. The ureterectomy is then closed with the interpreted absorber suture. The ureter is then wrapped in the adjusting pre-ureteric pad. A drain should be placed. The drain should be close to the ureterectomy, but not direct contact with the incision side. The incision is closed with a layer with muscle reposition is appropriate. Post-operative problem. The sepsis is a risk. Sepsis is a risk for any stone manipulation. And use of culture-specific broad-spectrum antibiotic is important in the preoperative period. Prolonged drainage suggests distal ureteric obstruction or ureteric devascularization. Management option including the placement of ureteric stent if it is not placed at the time of surgery. If the drain persists despite adequately stenting, then open surgery intervention may be required for repair of the ureter. Any manipulation of the ureter can lead to the structure formation. Structure are most likely caused by ureteric devascularization. The location of the structure is going to be determined the most suitable management option, which may including endoscopy as well as open surgical technique. Now we'll discuss the open cystorectomy indication. Despite the intermediates and advance in the endoscopic technique, cystorectomy is indicated for a patient with larger stone burden, which is mainly greater than 6 cm. Hard stone, abnormal anatomy, failure of an endoscopic approach, and concomitant open prostatectomy or diverticulectomy. Patient comorbid, previous surgery, and available instrument are also guide treatment decision. In all patients being with a clean urine and urine culture before undertaking any surgical procedure in urology. technique. The, place the patient in the supine position, prep and drape penis urethra into the field. Insert a 22FR balloon catheter and partially fill the bladder. Cover the penis and urethra and catheter with towel. This is a penicillin incision which mainly we have again, and this incision is a curved line incision and which is about 10 to 15 centimeter long, and skin and rectus sheets are open transversely using sharp dissection. Rectus muscle are not cut and the fascia is dissected along the rectus muscle. Push the peritoneum pole upward, leaving the pre-vesical pad. Throw the police catheter, fill the bladder capacity with sterile water, develop the retropubic space and place the retractor. Place two STS sutures in the dorsal wall above the pubic symbiosis. Ensure that there is adequately suction and end. Incise the detrusor muscle in a vertical fashion between the STS suture using electrocautery. Open the bladder to visualize the stone. The anterior bladder need not to be incised. Use the suction to remove excess aeration. Use the ring forceps, grab the stone and remove it from bladder. When a large incision is being made, place a suprapubic tube with a small cystostomy in the bladder and through the abdominal wall. Close the bladder into two layers using 3-0 Becquerel R on the mucosa and 2-0 Becquerel on the detrusor layer. The mucosa layer is closed first with a running suture. Close the detrusor layer also using a running suture. Test the closure by filling the bladder with sterilized water. Place a closed suction drain near the bladder closure. Leave the catheter for 8 to 10 days. Close the fascia with a 0 polydexine suture. A skin close is by surgeon preference. So this is a slide which shown. The incision is given, the muscle are splatted, and the stress suture is taken, and the stone removal is done, and then close the bladder in 2 layers. Conclusion. Although open surgery for treating urinary tract stone is really required at present, where most stone cases can be managed by minimally invasive therapy, we believe that it is still a role and it is of great importance to recognize that a small group of patients with complex stone disease and those with anatomical and physiological abnormalities will benefit from this open surgical treatment option. Thank you.
Sir, as rightly pointed by Dr. Rashid, sir, with the recent advances in the surgical techniques and the gadgets of the surgery, open surgery is rarely performed and being marked as a second or third line of intervention. But however, being in a third world country and a developing country, open surgical skills and still holds true for our settled. And secondly, not only it depends upon the gadgets of the surgery, it also depends upon the complex anatomy, and sometimes the patient preference is off the view. If we counsel the patient and ask the patient with the patient, sometimes the patient himself or herself wants to go for an open surgery rather for closed endoscopic procedure. So all these things should be kept in mind and should be considered before embarking upon the surgical technique and to decide upon what surgery we have to perform. So, and we should be kept our options open if we have a plan for a PCNL, for example, in a patient. And we should also seek a consent for the open surgery so that if approach is failed by PCNL, so we can convert into an open surgical technique. So open surgery, we should all be trained in that. So however, whenever an endoscopic surgical technique fails or we are short of some expertise or instruments, we can embark upon an open surgical technique.
Yes, rightly said, but the thing is, if the treatment option is available and if the technology is also available, then again, there are questions about logistics and economics, and these are the things which differ from region to region. When we say that we are a third world country, somebody would like it, somebody would not like it, but this is again a reality. And for instance, if I'm a resident of urology and I want to learn and educate myself to be trained in helping patients with urological diseases, then the center which imparts the training has to have everything on board. Now, having said that, it doesn't mean that we shouldn't go forward. We should always go backward and forward, but we should have everything available so that if a person goes out of a training institute, then that person should not be handicapped in dealing with a patient in any part of that country, at least. So if we are a citizen of this country, then all the realities and facts should be at the back of our hands. It is not a very good idea that we say that we live in cities and we are born in cities and we will work in cities. So what will happen to the villages or to the district health facilities, for instance? So all these things have to be taken into consideration whenever a bigger institute, a tertiary care center, has to come forward with something called training facility. So this is my take on the subject. So any institute of our country at the very end of the cutting technology should not be shy away from as simple as open surgery, for instance, because there are myriad of pathologies which are actually attached with the stone disease. So every patient needs a separate kind of a plan. And if you know the technique, how to deal with those stones, then you will be actually able to help out that particular person. So for instance, if I trained myself in reading guidelines which are for European continent or for American continent, then I will not be able to judge actually what will happen to my countrymen and how can they benefit from those guidelines which have been written for other people or for other regions, because they have got a very disparate kind of a situation. Their economics is totally different. Their health status is again totally different. They can't see many, many cases of Staghorn calculus, for instance. But this is a reality for this region, for Pakistan or for the neighboring country like India, maybe. So again, coming back to the same point that why is there a place for open surgery in this era of minimally invasive surgery? Somebody would say yes and somebody would say no. But I think yes is for us, and this is more prudent because, again, there is a wide gap between different parts of our country and we have to take care of every person living in this country.
Thank you. I think the role of open surgery is decreasing. I agree totally with this statement. And with the expertise in PCNL and ESERS and robotics, this will further decrease in the future at our center as well. Our data shows the 10% open surgical rate nowadays in the recent practice. But it was 19% in 2014 cases. So it's slowly decreasing. But I say that we get more complex diseases and the failure of endoscopic procedures or failure of robotic or laparoscopic procedures can happen, as you are saying. So we should be training our residents in open surgery as well. So in the case of any emergency, if there is a failure of endoscopic procedure, then we should be able to deal this case by open surgery. So yes, I agree that the indications are decreasing, but we still get more complex disease, so we should have at least exposure to open surgical procedures, especially the anatrophic nephrolithotomy or nephrolithotomy or difficult nephrectomies for stones are associated with other anomalies like harsh kidneys, pelvic kidney,
So, and with the pus, stones with the pus are the pyonephrosis are indications for this. So I think these are the okay, thank you. Thank you.